I think we're going to get started. I want to welcome you to our final cause event for the academic year 2016-17. I want to thank all of you for coming. Students, faculty, staff, administrators, and especially members of our larger Pittsburgh community. We really appreciate your ongoing support. I'm Joe Trotter, for those who haven't seen me or you're here for the first time. I'm the Giant Eagle Professor of History and Social Justice, and I direct the Center for African American Urban Studies and the Economy, better known as CAUSE. As always, I also want to thank our department chair, Donna Harsh, for the support that she gives to CAUSE, and as well, the dean, the provost's office, and the president's office provide essential resources to help us do what we do. And I can't forget the Giant Eagle Corporation and Foundation that supports our work, as well as BNY Mellon, the global philanthropy program that they have. I want to thank all of those outside funders for the work that they enable us to do. You may see Hikari Adey moving around, doing things. She is the program coordinator for CAUSE, and I just want to thank her for the work that she does. Over the past year, it has been a real pleasure to host historian Scot Brown as our 2016-17 postdoctoral fellow. Scot is right there. Okay. Scot is currently an associate professor of history and African American studies at UCLA. But I understand there are a lot of people who would like to recruit him away from UCLA. And I won't talk about the details, but of course, they are coming after him left and right. He has also taught at San Francisco State University, the University of Houston, and Emory University in Atlanta. Some of you may know that Earl Lewis was the provost at the university, what I should say, Emory University in Atlanta. And we brought him here in 2015 to receive an honorary doctorate degree at Carnegie Mellon. That's an aside. But Scot, getting back to Scot, Scot received his PhD from Cornell University in New York. He is an extraordinary scholar and colleague. He is the editor of a new study titled Discourse on Africana Studies, James Turner and Paradigms of Knowledge, published in 2016. He is also the author of the groundbreaking history of the Black nationalist organization called US, Fighting for US, Milana Coringa, the US Organization and Black Cultural Nationalism, published in 2003. When looking at this book upon its publication, leading scholars across the country in urban, political, and social history, and I'm talking about people like Claiborne Carson, the eminent historian of the Civil Rights Movement, Neil Irvin Painter, the pioneering social historian, and Robin D.G. Kelly, a major leading figure as a public intellectual as well as a scholar of labor, social, and cultural history. All of these scholars described Scot's work as groundbreaking, as setting the pace for research on Black nationalism. Fighting for US occupies a prominent place among studies by a young cohort of early 20th century historians. And these new historians that Scot represent a part of include people like Peniel Joseph, Yohuru Williams, Barbara Ransby, and lately, Donna Mersch, who has written a pioneering study of the Black Panther Party. Most important, at this moment, Scot Brown is emerging as a popular public and academic lecturer well beyond his home institution at the University of California in Los Angeles. Today, he will share with us portions of his forthcoming book on the history of funk in Dayton, Ohio. A few years ago, some of you may remember that Scott came to Carnegie Mellon as a cause lecturer. He shared with us the opening round of research on the subject that he will talk to us today about. Today, we will gain a more concrete preview of the book that will soon emerge from this project, Tales from the Land of Funk. This is an excellent talk to follow up on the last cause lecture by Waverly Duck. Those of you who were here, you'll know that Waverly, as well as you'll see Scott, they show that it's not just a matter of doing detailed case studies of a particular place, but that you have to think of these case studies as linking to larger processes. And in this case, as in Waverly's case, this study will link the emergence of this genre of music to larger socioeconomic and institutional transformations of the city's black community. And it will do so during the late 20th century under the impact of deindustrialization. It was this broader vision of Scott's work and his project that led us to select him as the cause postdoctoral fellow for 2016-17. And so we want to welcome Scot Brown for his second cause lecture.
Thank you so much. Let me first start by thanking Joe Trotter for his leadership, his impeccable and long-standing leadership, and almost unreal level of productivity in the midst of that leadership. And thank you to CAUSE, Carnegie Mellon as an institution, for having the foresight and vision to support CAUSE. And thank you also to the Pittsburgh community. I've been here since August. I thought I was going to be, you know, folks in California believe, especially in Southern California, that we can't live anywhere where the temperature is lower than 75 or hotter than 82. And if they could understand the warmth, generosity, sophistication, and culture of this town, they would expand the parameters of their perspective, as I have. Being here has been really immeasurable in terms of the progress I've been able to make. Let me begin by saying there's always a struggle around how to do a talk like this because there's so much information. So I have the kind of written out thing, but what I've discovered from writing out these articles on music is that writing about music is not nearly as funky as the music sounds. So I'm gonna be, if you don't mind, a lot more conversational and give you an overview of the project, and then we can drill down into some details, if you will, in the question and answer, if that's okay. All right? Well, let me start by saying that funk is more than just a four-letter word. It's a genre. It's a style of music that is a fusion of blues, gospel, R&B, soul, rock, and anything in between that we can think of comes together to make this potpourri called funk that has its high point in black popular music and popular music really from the mid-70s, a short-lived kind of run at the forefront of black popular music. And so that's roughly from 1975 to 1980. Now, the primary unit artistic unit in funk music. And this is a very important theoretical proposition. Is the self-contained band. All right? It's very important to understand that a band and a self-contained band, well, for a lot of my students, for instance, I'll say, well, there are no bands. There are no bands out. And they say, yes, there is. Erykah Badu has a band. No, she has a band. That's not a band. Earth, Wind, and Fire is a band. Cameo is a band. Slave is a band. Climax is an all-women's band. Okay? There's a self-contained entity in which there is a set of relationships between the instrumentalists and the vocalists that don't have the same kind of positioning, hierarchical positioning, that you see with Erykah Badu and her band. Now, ironically, we give sort of attribution to three main artists in terms of the development of funk. James Brown is certainly much more in the tradition of the lead singer out front. But what he did rhythmically with the band in terms of polyrhythms, focus on the first beat, all these sonic relationships that are still with us today is what makes James Brown not only the godfather of soul, but also one of the main innovators of funk. How do we get to bands, though? We get to bands because of an artist out of the Bay Area, Sly and the Family Stone, a self-contained band. And if you look at that group, you'll see that Sly is not in the front. Larry Graham on bass is closer to the audience than he is in many cases, or his brother on guitar. So there's a communal ethos. The person that we sort of ascribe, or I should say the band that we ascribe the kind of far-reaching philosophical dimensions of funk is the group Parliament Funkadelic, led by great funk philosopher George Clinton. Right, I can do a whole separate lecture there, but you all have to discipline me a little bit from not being tempted to chase down some of these tangents that are going to come up as we go. So now, what about this notion of the band? How is it a reflection of urban realities? I am not from Dayton, Ohio, contrary to what some of you all might think. Because I have had to, really, people like you've got to be from there. My interest in Dayton, Ohio and funk grows out of probably growing up in a city that has a similar kind of industrial social reality. That's upstate New York, Rochester, New York. Very different from Eastern Seaboard, New York and all that other stuff. Upstate, you can think about us as sort of Eastern Ohio, if you will. Buffalo, Rochester, Syracuse. My three favorite bass players were Marshall Jones from the Ohio Players, Mark Adams from Slave, and Marvin Craig from the group Lakeside. I did not realize at the time that all three of these bass players come from this town, Dayton, Ohio. So, as I was sort of finishing up Fighting for Us, I have the last chapter of Fighting for Us is called In the Face of Funk. And I'm already facing the funk, thinking about my next project and wanting to answer similar kinds of questions like what is the social, cultural infrastructure at the core? Why Dayton, Ohio? Dayton, Ohio has, and this is a quantitative claim that I'm going to back up, the highest number of bands signed to major labels, self-contained bands, came from Dayton, Ohio. There are some close rivals, but Dayton surpasses them all. Roughly 14 to 15 bands in a city that has a population of roughly 200,000, that has a deeply embedded and rich Black music education tradition, which I'll talk about, a community that is also living in a community, a home sphere, as the great historian Earl Lewis would say, that is also shaped by the spatial politics of race. Since the Second World War, waves of African Americans that migrated from the South found themselves living in an area known as West Dayton, which is divided from East Dayton by the Miami River. And so West Dayton would become synonymous with Black Dayton. That's still fairly, pretty much the case today. But the space of that community would grow as issues around desegregation would take hold, and you have the issue of white flight moving eastward and northward in Montgomery County. So I'm interested in these relationships. I hope that we will get to something that takes a forward step in the development of what I hope to be a kind of African-American studies paradigm of music studies, which I differentiate from cultural studies because the emphasis is not simply on the narrative or discourse. Differentiating it from music studies in that we're not just talking about sound, but we're also talking about sociologies of music simultaneous to this discussion about the music itself. But let me get back to my quantitative claim. I think we have some doubters in the room. I see some people, they got that look of skepticism, you see? So I'm gonna have to deal with this, okay? All right. I'm just getting started. This is a song called All the Way Live by the group Lakeside. We will return to the concept of All the Way Live as a kind of ethos or paradigm that other groups often express as well. But let me get back to the quantitative issue.
Wow.
I'm gonna let this play a little bit. Players just got lucky.
Yeah.
They had a string of hits, but after all,
you are bad.
Dayton is a funk epicenter. Many of you have gone to weddings. You heard the song Always and Forever sung at the wedding. You may have disco danced to Boogie Night. Also traveled on the Groove Line by the band Heatwave, which is an international group. But the lead singer, Johnny Wilder, Dayton, Ohio, his brother, Keith Wilder, from Dayton, the guitarist, Billy Jones, Dayton, Ohio. The group also has probably the greatest songwriter in modern pop history, Rod Temperton on keyboards. That's a whole story about what happened to him. We'll talk about that later. Bilbo from Czechoslovakia. Mario Mentize from Spain. And I'm not sure. I'm thinking that's Eric John from the UK. Band was formed when Johnny Wilder in the army was stationed in Germany and formed in Switzerland as the Chicago Heatwave. Because, of course, you say Dayton Heatwave. Listen to that bass. He was locking in with the drums. That's a group called Slave. And I can talk about a lot of hits and how important they are. I'm gonna digress and freestyle a little bit here. As I was going through the archives in the black newspaper, Jetstone newspaper, I got this slick thing of doing word search in a PDF. So I wrote the group, I wrote the word Slave, thinking I'm gonna find something about the band. I see March 16th, Slave Day. It's a slave day. Like it's some kind of Juneteenth thing. It was the day that Mayor McGee of Dayton declared in 1981, March 16th, a local holiday commemorating the band Slave. The article ended with the mayor admonishing the group to be careful with their monies and hire somebody professional to handle it. There's some omens there that we will revisit later. again, returning to Lakeside. First song I played was by All the Way Live. This is fantastic for you. One quality of the live bands in Dayton, Ohio is they sing about their prowess. You're riding on the groove line. We're gonna take you on a fantastic voyage. It's All the Way Live. That's an important feature of the show band character of funk bands that were prominent in this period, which we will return to later as we get into the basis for them. I'm the captain of this vessel. We want to take you on a cruise. Steve Arrington's Hall of Fame, Weak at the Knees, a song that has been sampled by multiple rap artists, but still, again, part of that tradition of self-contained band. Come on, we're the doubters. I want to see you. Don't be scared now. All right. I'm having too much fun. So, the idea that a Dayton, Ohio, we still have to get to the why question, why Dayton? And I want to suggest here that I'm not arguing for a kind of Dayton exceptionalism. What I have come to view as part and parcel of why we are able to tell this story is that there are factors beyond the control. We tend to think of music cities, Detroit, Memphis, Philadelphia, because of the entrepreneurial activity around music. We tend to think of those as music hubs because of the record labels. That doesn't necessarily say anything about the quantity of necessarily the local. So is there something about Detroit, or is there really an organization of cultural working class resources that makes it distinct from other places? I'll get to why Dayton in a second. I want to say that what artistic celebrity in these cases does is it gives us a window, I argue, into cultural realities that expand far beyond these places. So I think the story of Dayton is also the story of Pittsburgh. It's the story of Buffalo, New York. It's the story of many places with similar conditions, and it may actually, in terms of numbers, quantity of musicians, quantity of local musicians, it may not really be that different. What's different are factors that are outside of the control of these kind of characteristics. So for instance, I ask people all the time, another Midwestern musical hub, Minneapolis, Minnesota. Prince, right? The Time, Mint Condition, Alexander O'Neill, all of them from Minneapolis. Why do we know about that? Because Prince Rogers Nelson got a record deal with Warner Brothers with the assistance of a local music cultural activist named Owen Husney. Now, what would have happened if Prince did not get that record deal? He would still be a musician. And so there would still be that local culture, but we wouldn't be aware of it. What kind of factor pushes the Dayton story to the fore? I argue that it is the institution, local institution of the Ohio Players. Ohio Players are a group that started in the early 1960s, first known as the Ohio Untouchables. And they were the backup band for blues extraordinaire Robert Ward. And that was their first experience with the issue of, how I say this, LSE, lead singer ego. We all know lead singers like to go solo. And the ethic of the self-contained band was, in the case of the Ohio Players, a pushback against that, as they would face it often. Most importantly, though, the Ohio Players, unlike and very much like Prince, stayed in this small town at the height of their career. So they had this incredible run of platinum albums. Skin Tight, Fire, Honey. You notice these words here. Skin Tight, Fire, Honey, Contradiction, Angel. All right? But, and they're known for, of course, their explicit, sexualized, highly sexualized album covers, which we can talk about as well. But the point is, they stayed in Dayton, Ohio the whole time. So what does that do to a community when you go to a supermarket and you can see Sugarfoot and you can see Sugarfoot's Lamborghini with his name written on the side of it in the parking lot? Or if you break a guitar string and you get a dare as a young person, this is a true story, let's go to Sugarfoot's house and see if he'll give us a guitar string. And you end up getting a guitar string and getting a musical lesson as a consequence of that. That has a transformative impact on a local community, particularly a small town. Those are the kinds of things, I mean, again, if I go back to my searches in Jetstone News, you get a sense for how much the Ohio Players were so much more than just a band from Dayton. There was an article about the First Lady. So, again, I see the title, First Lady. So I'm thinking, President's wife is in Dayton. It was a party that was given for Satch's wife, Carolyn Satchel. And all this talk about the extravagance of the pool party and who was there, completely relevant in the context of that local setting. And it could befuddle somebody who's not really a part of that story. Another article I found was on the Ohio Players women's auxiliary unit that were buying and giving gifts to kids, poor kids, around Christmas time. And so the way that they functioned, and this is a different way of thinking about a band, particularly in this context, and I'm thinking about it as an institution that runs parallel and in tandem with other institutions. This is bluesman Robert Ward, who the Ohio Untouchables backed up at first. Ohio Players went through a lot of different changes, so the imprimatur of the lead singer really shaped the period in time. When the Ohio Players were with Westbound Records, their front person was, and this person was a real musical genius that played instruments and drums very much like him, Walter Junie Morrison. When the Ohio Players in 1973 had the opportunity to leave Westbound and go to Mercury Records, Junie got a solo record deal from Westbound, again with the idea that the lead singer was a front person and of course the Players would be doomed. Again, LSE, and the Ohio Players moved forward. In moving forward, they decided once and for all, no more lead singers. So who's going to be the front person now? Leroy Sugarfoot Bonner from Hamilton, Ohio, who was always in the band when they were formed as the Ohio Players, but was a quiet guitarist and quite shy. And he was told, ordered by the leader, you are going to figure out how to be the lead singer. And that's where you get his innovation as a stylist, to listen to him talking back. Right here. Sort of a He's the one that brought the owl to funk. From his blues background. So the Ohio Players were this institution. The other institution that the Ohio Players drew from were the high schools. And so Dayton, Ohio developed, as in the case of so many other places, a very rich music tradition within those segregated schools. This is Roosevelt High School, which I'll come back to in the story. And this is Charles Spencer. Charles Spencer was the music teacher that most artists from Dayton attribute a certain amount of training from. He required knowledge of music theory to participate in extramural musical activities. So if you're going to play in the band, if you're going to be in a talent show, if you're going to do this, you have to take his class and pass musical theory. He also, to raise money for school band, organized talent shows with other schools, talent competitions, which really fostered a sense of competition and showmanship. Lots of really, really rich stories in this work about the lengths to which young people displayed uncanny creativity in their quest to win these talent shows that are quite rich. But they had a experienced jazz musician. Spencer would sometimes chaperone young musicians when they were performing in nightclubs. He had relationships with the parents. And it really was a part of the social fabric of the neighborhood, the Residence Park, Westwood area, particularly of West Dayton. Now, churches are obviously a kind of established institution that we think about when we think about the roots of African-American music and musical training. We often neglect, though, the importance of the schools. And so there are a number of teachers that that emerge in this story that are quite central to the cultivation of the craft on the part of these artists. It's important here because I think there's a tendency with funk to think that the groove is just something people do. But the chord progressions are things that are actually thought out and calculated. I would urge you all to listen to the album Fire. And there's a song in there called Hell. It was deliberately written in the tritone, with a tritone chord, which has been some tones that people associate with the devil. It's deliberately written in that way, and you'll be able to hear some really interesting innovation there. Now, bands in Dayton, Ohio were very much a male-dominated social network. One issue that would delineate between access to participating in bands as a musician would be really parental acceptance of late-night hours in local nightclubs. Most parents were extremely lenient with young men in, young boys actually, in playing in bands. What you find is also a kind of gendered way that certain instruments are understood. So the boys that were playing clarinet in elementary school, in high school, switched to saxophone. Many of the women that stayed with instruments like the clarinet or the cello were still confined to avenues of musical expression like that were connected to the school, connected to church, but they didn't often translate into participating in these self-contained bands. It's something I'm thinking more about, but that's not the end of talking about gender in this context. Women vocalists, as had been the case, has been the case in so many other genres, were certainly able to make their voice so central and an instrument in its own right. And then many women vocalists, this is the only all-women's funk band in Dayton, Ohio. It's called Hot Number. Formed in 1978, 1979, named after the song by Foxy called Hot Number. If you look up top, you'll see the group called Flash. And in the center, you see a young Vesta Williams. I don't know if you're familiar with her, but a phenomenal vocalist from Dayton, Ohio. This is Daria Stone in the group called The Four Corners. You know, there's obviously more than four of them in the group. But Daria talked about the reason why she could keep late hours is because, and you can't really see it here, the manager of the group was a woman named Margaret Harris. If you, and that fine print up there, this record by this group, The Fabulous Originals, was produced by Margaret Harris, known as Angel. Margaret Angel Harris, she says, is the person that secured her parents' confidence that she could keep late hours with this band, perform, and also would do that kind of negotiating a sense of security with the group. So there's a whole story of women managers of bands that hasn't been told that this story in Dayton, Ohio exposes. Local radio is central to the development of local celebrity and also local music markets, not just in Dayton, Ohio, but in Dayton, Ohio's case, the radio station is WBAO. What you're hearing in the background is a song by Roger More Bounce to the Ounce. But the song is called Free Freedom. This is a song, the version of it, that came out as a local hit. It got heavy rotation in Dayton, Ohio. So a young person in Dayton could actually see a group grow in their midst, listen to them get played on local radio, because DJs at that time had considerable discretion over what they played compared to what they do now. And they could buy the record, you saw the pressed record earlier, from B&D Record Store, the local record store. So this idea about celebrity and its locality is very important to this story as well. And that happens with the Ohio Players, their early releases as well. Let me get back to the self-contained band, and I talked about sort of the local driving forces. Before I move into this, though, I want to stress the importance of the availability of relatively high-wage jobs. That is really part and parcel of why so many young people grew up in families that could afford instruments. In many cases, and this is something that's sort of something that we've lost in the era of post-industrial reality, afford lessons from private local music teachers that came to people's homes and taught them how to play, especially piano, in many cases on one income at jobs at Frigidaire, McCall's, Chrysler Steering, a number of adjacent businesses that also thrive because of the availability of manufacturing jobs. So that's sort of the economic base for these kinds of cultural developments. And we'll see as we go forward what happens when, in this period, when we're going through some transitions as far as the jobs are concerned. Ironically, as groups start to get record deals, roughly around 1977-78, so the Ohio Players sort of opened this pathway. And their disciples, Slave, Lakeside, Roger Troutman, they all get record deals roughly around 1977. The very pillars, though, of that local culture is actually eroding as those groups get signed. And that's really the irony. So I try to figure out how to talk about declension here. By the time this local culture rises to prominence as far as getting on national airways, those very bands that are disciples of the Ohio Players are not able to do what the Ohio Players did as far as training another generation that has access to the things that they had. So, you know, we're dealing with, you know, challenges to this idea of linear progress. Things can go forward and backward at the same time, particularly when we're dealing with political and cultural economies. But the establishment of major corporate labels that want to get a crack at the black music consumer market is tied up in a self-contained band. So CBS Records signed Sly and the Family Stone, or Columbia. Larkin Arnold, that's who this executive is over the black division at Capitol Records. He's so powerful, he's a law graduate from Howard University. He's so powerful that he, unlike other executives over divisions, can actually sign an artist on his own. In Dayton, Ohio, there's a group called Sun. Not really big, but funketeers know who they are. Hardcore funketeers know who they are. Larkin Arnold signed Sun sight unseen. He got caught up in a snowstorm and couldn't make it to Dayton when they were supposed to do a showcase. But they had sent him the demo, and he made a phone call, and he said, "I like the music, you got a record deal." That was the kind of power that music executives Larkin Arnold, LeBaron Taylor with CBS, Logan Westbrooks with CBS, over what was called Black Divisions. How does that relate here is that the self-contained band was the artist form that really coincided with major corporate interests in black music markets. Capitol Records, Larkin Arnold also signed the female duo, A Taste of Honey, Boogie Oogie Oogie. Right? So you just can't boogie no more. And when she challenges this idea of the masculine stronghold over certain instruments, when she says, "Listen to my bass play, boom, 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 boom," okay? That's the foresight, though, of Larkin Arnold. Now, let me get back to the ironies. Dayton is the site of a major battle over desegregation policy. 1974, you have what is known as the Dayton II decision, a Supreme Court decision which really expands the scope of what a desegregation plan can do. Roosevelt High School's doors are closed by 1975. And this story also complicates the idea about the values and the policy considerations of desegregation. So there was a busing order. Eventually, students and teachers are bused to other schools, but with the speed of white flight, eventually you have a situation where black students are being bused from one black side of town to another. Robin Kelly talks about the irony of these policies coming and coming at a time of really in the midst of the throes of deindustrialization for a lot of places. The unemployment rate in Dayton, Ohio in 1970 was roughly, according to the census, 7.8% in the black community. It became 19.3% in 1980. That is a catastrophic transformation of the social landscape at the same time. So we're trying to get to thinking about these relationships, which explains in part why groups like Slave, Lakeside, Roger Troutman don't have local heirs because of these kinds of changes. Also sonically, big band funk that had horn sections and timbales were displaced by the synthesizer, by the drum machine. This is one of the few Ohio bands that survived that transition, Midnight Star. You see how many of them there are? Because the horn players didn't get kicked out of the group. They were just assigned other jobs, more keyboards, more electronic drums, more dance steps. And you get this song, No Parking on the Dance Floor. See, it sounds very different. Other groups that survived this transition, groups like Entume, Juicy Fruit, groups like, I'm trying to think of another one. Oh, the most important one from Dayton, Ohio, Roger Troutman and Zapp. So there's a way that we can talk about sound, the downsizing of the sound, in conjunction with the downsizing of manufacturing bases in cities like Dayton and all over the country. Now, this song came out in the mid-80s. It's called Computer Love. There was no internet that he could have access to. When Roger Troutman said, "Could this be your face I see on my computer screen?" his reference would have been more likable to be the Jetsons rather than anything approximating social reality. And the song laments the challenges that come with technology and its effect on social relationships. So where does this take us as far as thinking about a way of talking about declension without repeating the same kinds of mistakes that many historians make when we talk about decline? We like these neat packages. Unfortunately, in this story, it's not so simple, because Black working class communities, especially youth cultures, have ways of enduring change and creating in the midst of them. California love. Dayton funk is finding a new home in the early 90s as these bands are no longer in place through the use of sampling and hip hop. This is Dr. Dre and Tupac, California Love, and you can hear that's Roger Troutman in the background. Most music scholars are quick to talk about hip-hop as the result of the loss of jobs, the loss of music in the schools, but they jump over the brief period of time in which there was a symmetry between access to jobs, local performance, local identities for artists, the very basis for that period in which funk bands were important in Black popular music. Currently, especially since the 2000s onward, there's been a kind of nostalgia around funk. This is the song by Bruno Mars, which is its own tribute to Roger Troutman. Unfortunately, though, many of the veteran artists that created these sounds are still struggling both for recognition and economic support. One major effort to reverse these kinds of trends is the Funk Music Hall of Fame and Exhibition Center in Dayton, Ohio, led by David Webb and a whole group of others in Dayton. It's been around for a couple of years. They have interesting programming. But the challenge of the Funk Center, and even the challenge that I see for this project, is to think about the dynamic. The availability of jobs, the availability of community in the public sphere gave us funk. What we aim to do now is to take the funk and help to build jobs and a vibrant public sphere. And that is the challenge that lies before us and an African American studies paradigm for Black music studies. Thank you. Okay, any questions? All right, great. Questions, comments?
I just want to add one more part. Mm-hmm. Take it back a couple of years.
Sure.
That funk was already out there, mm-hmm. because we did it in
Vietnam.
Yes.
That's how we survive.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, when we come back at our patrol, mm-hmm. we had our little parties, mm. we listened to the funk.
Wow.
So it was there.
Yes, absolutely. And were you listening to Funkadelic, P-Funk? Was it the psychedelic funk?
The psychedelic, all that entailed.
Wow, absolutely.
Because we would have people would get these little CD tapes set,
mm-hmm.
and we'd party all night.
Wow.
And go out on patrol the next day.
Man, funk not only moves, it removes.
Yep.
The desired effect is what you get when you explore your interplanetary funkmanship.
So that's why I said I beg to differ. It was there.
Oh no, I'm not. I agree. It was there, and I think it's there in so many different ways that I hope that this story gets us to ask a different set of questions to expand the locale where we think music cultures emerge. So that's why I said earlier I'm not talking about a kind of urban exceptionalism. There's a kind of neo-urban tribalism that we have where everybody wants to rep their city and say they were the only ones doing something. Mm-hmm. When the social conditions are similar, there are actually similar outcomes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes?
This sort of feeds into my comment slash question. Mm-hmm. So I've done some research in oral histories here in Pittsburgh, mm-hmm. Jazz in the 50s and 60s, particularly mm-hmm. in the Hill District, which is vibrant. There are a bunch of clubs and strong union for musicians. I mean, there's a lot of overlap with music education, with good jobs, just a lot of these things. Mm-hmm. I think jazz in the 50s and 60s
mm-hmm.
Is just a similar story. So that's my comment. My question is, how do you fit that narrative about jazz and funk later? How does jazz fit into your story? Or does it not at all?
Oh, it's central to it. Because jazz musicians need work. So what do? They give up the funk. If you listen to Cold Sweat, ba-dun, that's a riff off of Miles Davis. Jazz musicians find the popular marketplace limited really by the late 50s. Rock and roll is filled with jazz musicians. When you look back at the Ohio Players, they were blues and jazz musicians before. So funk owes particularly its brass elements to jazz. And that's part of what gives it that dynamic. And the other, I think, difference here is that you're dealing with this transition. I mean, I'd be interesting to know how you kind of grapple with avant-garde jazz, too, right? So there's a point at which jazz is no longer dance music, and it's no longer connected to youth culture, right? Jazz musicians have a way of figuring out in the 60s and 70s how to remain kind of connected to dance culture by experimenting. But there's an ongoing discussion about selling out. The first sellout was selling out from acoustic instruments to electric instruments. That debate took place. A lot of the debates that are still going on about synthesizers and drum machines are similar in that regard. So I'd be interested also to just how you kind of work through this question of authenticity in jazz. But I think it's the same kind of story, but it just lines up differently within the context of the wider music marketplace.
I noticed in your talk you're using the not only the lyrics but the music as a primary source.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm wondering, like, what methodology or approach or theory are you using to kind of bring this to use this funk music as a source?
Well, that's a great question, and you see, I believe that academics mystify theory, and that from the school of a lot of scholars like my mentor Robin Kelly and others, I tend to try to extrapolate theory from the commentary language of everyday people and bring that to the surface. So I'm trying to give you a really good example of that. So when I think about, for instance, band leaders' insistence of the placing of a group where the lead singer is not up front, and I listen to their quotes around why they want it that way, I think of that as an egalitarian or communal ethos as articulated from the people. So I don't have an overarching sonic theory. Plus also, I'm a bass player, I'm a funketeer. I don't need anybody telling me how to interpret the music. I think I got the music. I think I know what I'm talking. So that's, you know, a problem, actually, because there are a lot of people, especially with the kind of currency, I think when we talk about interdisciplinarity in the academy, we're really talking about a shared language of theory to talk across disciplines. We're actually not talking about, in many, unless you're Du Bois or Zora Neale Hurston, we're not talking about people who have actually mastered multiple disciplines to that extent. So that's something I struggle with, actually, quite honestly. And I'm just starting to read musicology. So I came to this study really from the ground up. And so I don't have a theory. I hear stuff. I use my own language and my own words to talk about these relationships. Sometimes they make sense. Sometimes there's some very bright person in the room that says, well, you know, that doesn't, you know, and I'm open to it. Recently, I've been really in close dialogue with leading ethnomusicologist Portia Maltby, who really is the best of both worlds in that she's a musician and she's the leading music theorist. And so far, I've been doing all right. But I am cautious, though, of that. Do you have anything in mind
I'm thinking through it myself right now. I'm working on my perspectives.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm looking at hip-hop as a challenge, a response to, a direct response to the war on drugs.
Yeah.
And so I'm looking at exploring one chapter where, you know, I have KRS-One and NWA, mm-hmm. Public Enemy,
mm-hmm.
and I want to use their direct rhetoric, their direct lyrics, right, to this challenge, like speaking to politicians, government, even middle class African Americans. And it's like how I'm thinking, and thinking through it, I'm thinking, how do I, what theory do I facilitate this?
KRS-One is your theorist. You've got the theorist, in my opinion, and the artist. So if I take, for instance, a concept like extra spatiality, I'm going to George Clinton. I'm going to Psycho Alpha Disco Beta Bio Aqua Doolip, a motion picture underwater star Mimosa Yulus, Aqua Boogie, right? I'm going internal, going inside to get outside through the artist as theorist. And I think that is an untapped resource because we all, let's look at the manufacturer theory. Let's try to unpack it. You have a kind of conceptual idea, and you find ways that people cite different sources, and it's really usually a repackaging, and repackaging in a way that sheds light on something that we may miss with the current language. And I think artists are doing these kinds of things, not just in their lyrics, but also in their sonic arrangements. So you can find the language, but I think I find it rewarding to elevate the artist as theorist in my work.
Do you have a sense of what Southern states really fuel Dayton population most, and if they put that down?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, Georgia. Not just Georgia, the area around Noonan, Georgia. That's Robert Ward, that's a whole group of folks from this, you know, area, you know, of Georgia, and there are actually, now I have evidence of sort of how that trail starts, so where people talk about, yeah, I came, so-and-so heard about me coming, so I find Georgia be one of the biggest ones, and then also people coming from sort of intermediary states they settled in, like Tennessee, Kentucky, but so they may have roots in the Delta, but they have families that live in sort of the Midwest or other parts of the South on the way up. And there are also people that had intentions on going elsewhere that ended up in Dayton. in part because of family ties. But if I can find a geography that has the most number of people that constantly comes up, it's in that area of Georgia.
And the reason I raise that is the emphasis on the school as a trainer. Mm-hmm. Is that coming out of this Georgia environment for black musicians or training people?
Yeah, see, I haven't found evidence to be the case because of the very how poor some of those early migrants were, that many of whom did not have access to public education. What I found to be the driving force around the school has been the interesting way in which segregated black schools were a source of pride for many. And so there are a lot of music teachers, like Charles Spencer, who had a doctorate, but in the 1940s and 50s, where do these trained music teachers get jobs? Oftentimes it's in high schools. And so he was one of them. There was the black school, Dunbar High School, which was created in the 1930s. The Roosevelt High School was actually internally segregated. So there was a separate black pool in the school. Sports teams were segregated. And the anger that black residents had led them to actually lobby for the establishment of Dunbar High School, which is a black school, self-consciously black school in the 1930s. And so there are ways that I'm interested in thinking about what the Southern experience would bring to that, but I found the factors that led to education to be more around the way people in Dayton, Ohio, possibly through elevated expectations and their responses to the onset of racism, led to this kind of institution building.
Very, very enjoyable presentation. I like your connection between instrumentality and sort of the socio-political context that provides these musicians with their training and their exposure to instrumentation and how you actually talk about the performance. So that's a nice link and a very compelling argument. But I am a little curious, given this part of your presentation focused more on the sound, the rhythm, do you see any particular context or lack of context for these changes economically and socially in Dayton in the late 70s, early 80s, in the lyrics, in the actual sort of content of the song in that perspective? Is it reflective of the time? Is it escapist? Can you trace the content of the song to the same sort of economic context?
Sure. Oh, no, I love that. I love that. Great question. Yes, I can. You remember that song I played by Roger Troutman, More Bounce to the Ounce? Mm-hmm. Yeah. More Bounce. I'm just curious. Anybody, tell me what you think that song is about.
Music.
Anybody else? Drugs?
Oil crisis?
Well, okay. Well, I'm just telling you, Roger Troutman said that song was about bounce checks. And when those checks bounce, all you can do is just party. So, there, because you can't change it anyway. So, and I use that example to say that the whole idea of space for celebration in the midst, you know, we talk about these dualities in other genres. It's very pronounced in the funk because so much of funk is a celebration of community. It's a celebration of being together, but it doesn't necessarily mean that the conditions are that great, right? So how young people fought to create spaces to congregate with hip hop is also happening in its own way with funk. So lyrically, I found a lot of music scholars to think that a song that talks about a fantastic voyage is non-political. So the politics is really in the context. So if they're talking about a fantastic voyage in a working class town that gravitates toward these spaces for empowerment, the political meaning is not in just sort of dissecting discursively, you know, the meaning, but it's placing it in that kind of context. And I think even as we go into the politics of race in the music industry, we'll find that there's also a constant commentary on this notion of free space and self-determination. So that's where I find it, but it's not the kind of politics. So what's different about Dayton Funk and Funk in general, in many cases politics is discussed, if it's explicit, it's in a metaphorical way. George Clinton, of course, is the expert in that. But it's very different from soul, and the Philadelphia soul, which sort of, you know, takes on an explicit political character, but having such beautiful harmonies that you don't realize that they're talking about some very harsh things. You know, you got bad luck, that's what you got. You lost your job, you're on the street, you just give up. And they dance to it, right? But Funk, though, talks about the experiential dimension. So there are lots of ways that the lyrics, so I don't find that, unfortunately, the lyrical focus doesn't change in the 80s. What changes is much more of a sonic transformation and a pushback. Hip hop is in many respects, some of it, not all of it, is a pushback to the kind of theatricality of funk. Nobody walks around really in the neighborhood looking like Rick James, see, in 1981. So Run DMC, my Adidas, my Lee jeans, and they look on stage very different. They look on stage in hip hop in many cases after they get past the Afrika Bambaataa and the Grandmaster Flash stage where they look like they're from outer space. Then they start to pride themselves on looking on stage the same way that an everyday person would look. And so there's a kind of neorealism there. That in the early stages, and maybe, you know, we have some younger folks here who know more about this than me, but recently, but in that period, there's a pushback against the flamboyance of funk. And also lyrically, there's a shift toward the kind of dynamic that was happening with soul in hip hop, a kind of realism, protest, explicit protest lyrics. That's what I'm kind of working through. Yes, I'm sorry, and I'm forgetting some other folks that had their hands up. Okay, all right, thank you.
I was wondering about, wasn't the bass player the lead singer, or, and there was no hierarchy where the bass player was the big deal, or in the band, or?
Right, yeah, I think you mean in terms of the centrality of the bass player.
Yeah,
yeah.
That's what drives it, and so I had assumed that it was their band.
Wow.
Or.
Yeah, no, that's very interesting. Funk really is the first genre, I think, in popular music to elevate the bass player to such a central place. And that's in part because of the dynamism of Larry Graham, who was the bass player with Sly and the Family Stone, and some of the ways that he's doing melodic and very flamboyant things that most of these artists that I'm talking about are trying to emulate. And that period of the live bass being front and central starts to decline in the 80s too with the expansion of the synthesizer into those that kind of space as well. But you're absolutely right. In fact, you know, I just got back. I do research every now and then. I go to these concerts and I get to see these groups. And I got to see the group Kool & the Gang, right? Now, a lot of people don't know who Kool is. They think Kool is JT Taylor. Kool is the bass player. And Kool is cool. Kool is a fan because all he has to do is play those bass lines and cash those checks. All right? And that's a dynamic because people expect the lead singer to be the front person. So when JT went solo, Kool & the Gang is still moving on. They're still touring. And again, that's that self-contained band ethos that pushes back there. So I think you're absolutely right. The bass becomes central here.
And they started as a jazz band.
Mm, that's right. They started as a jazz band. And that's what Hollywood swinging. You know, it's so interesting because if I had anybody to be, it wouldn't be Marcus Miller. It wouldn't be Stanley Clarke. It wouldn't be I'd rather be Kool. Because Kool does bass lines that we all remember. Boom, 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 boom. And so you can't hum a lot of the stuff that the fancy, more technically oriented bass players do, but you can. You can remember a cool bass line. Mm-hmm. Who's next?
So I actually grew up about 10 minutes outside of Dayton. So
oh, wow, okay.
And I had no idea about any.
I mean, I've heard a few, I recognize the songs, but I had no idea that they were from Dayton. And I was actually, I had stumbled across an article of yours online maybe a decade ago. I've been going down this wormhole since, so thank you.
thank you.
And it also makes me think, so when I was in high school in the mid-90s, I played in my school's marching band, and there were a lot of local marching bands that were competing on a national level, winning national championships. Ours wasn't a jazz-focused marching band, but a lot of the local Dayton area bands were jazz-focused marching bands. And they, nobody was playing these bands at all. They were playing, shows of Chicago music, power music, or, and it just, it blew my mind that nobody in Dayton knows about these bands. And I was just curious, I've read since about the Hall of Fame, but I was just curious if you had any thoughts about why it's,
that's been a blessing and a problem. The good part has been because a lot of folks had not really, when I started to do research on this, consolidated this. They were, folks in Dayton are very open and generous. They don't sort of have a, you're an outsider coming in here. In fact, it was the opposite. It was more a feeling that we need to tell our story. And so I'm glad to have been a part of contributing to the development of more institutions that recognize it. But I think it's also, the kind of, I don't want to psychologize this, but so self-esteem issues of small working class towns that don't have, not like Pittsburgh with three sports teams, Dayton, Ohio. So you're constantly on the defensive. So even when I proposed this project, when I started it, most people, I had to do, that's why I did the whole spiel about not being from Dayton, because of the skepticism of a town like that. So there is that sense of longing. Even Cincinnati has sports teams, King Records, the record label by James, that James Brown was with us there. So, but what does Dayton have? So it becomes a difficult kind of effect on people's sense of the cultural memory. And then also I think the role of popular music and the way that popular music would sample these artists without attribution. So much of this project is a real memory project or knowledge building project, just getting people aware of those kind of connections that are not necessarily present. Now, television shows like Unsung that I've, and music documentary shows are starting to expand, and I think that's starting to have some impact as well.
Yes, sir. Dr. Brown, first of all, thank you very much. I appreciate your presentation. Just about three comments. But one is just that you said something about the bass being out front, the Rimmler and jazz, Charlie Mingus came out front decades ago.
That's right.
Yeah. But what I really want to say is that I'm looking forward to your project because it's raising an old issue, and that is Black music as the history or record of Black people.
Yes.
Sterling Brown said that, Aileen Rock, Amiri Baraka said that in Blues People.
Yes.
And there's a contemporary scholar, Bahara Jasmine Griffin. She was here, I guess that was last year. And she wrote that book, If You Can't Be Before You Be a Mystery, In Search of Billie Holiday. And that's what she's focusing on. I remember in her question was, I go back, I can't get past Coltrane and all of those. But anyhow, sure. And I'm not trying to get past. There's a Minnie Riperton. She took three Black female popular singers from from the 1970s, and she counterposed them to the image of black women doing BAM, the Black Arts Movement. And the question she asked was, what does the music of a specific period, black music of a specific period, say about that period? And I think that some of the things that you're raising such issues in your work.
Yes, sir.
And, but jazz funk, looking at that within the context of post-industrial, then we can look at jazz and blues and gospel in terms of the black migration.
Absolutely.
And one last point. There's a great scholar called Lloyd Hogan. Nobody reads it, but he wrote a book called Principles of Black Political Economy. Mm-hmm. And one thing he says about the black migration that I really thought was profound, he said if you look at what they call Kansas City jazz, all of those schools, Chicago, New York, he said what they are doing is when they name those places, they are retracing the footsteps of the black migration, mm-hmm. which is the black revolution, where the black people were transformed from a sharecropper peasantry mm-hmm. to an urban proletariat. And so that mm-hmm. you will be taking that further, and what happens to the black community in terms of post-industrial, and what black music says about that.
Absolutely.
I really look forward to your work.
Thank you. No, you're spot on in terms of what I hope to accomplish. In many cases, we think of music, when we hear the sound and popular styles, we think of it as sort of a top-down experience. What I hope to do is to unpack the bottom-up nature that black music comes up from communities. And blues, people made that argument about the blues, and so I would like to do something similar in this book in terms of changing the way we think about music in relationship to community. So that's definitely... the objective, and it's also my own sort of pushback against, I think, and then somebody's going to probably not like this, but I think but the way that we kind of talk about music so much as a narrative, so trying to make music as a literary text, and that's an important dimension. But there's a social dimension, there's all these other dimensions that we can explore that will enrich the way we think of music as a kind of social currency that interlocks families, interlocks neighborhoods, interlocks communities. It's a way that we navigate gender issues, gender conflict, patriarchy. So if we think of it that way, I think we have really an opportunity to discover some very, very powerful stories that will contribute to the ongoing project that I'm committed to decolonizing working class culture, decolonizing the cultural resource that is created by working classes that I argue is the real engine of U.S. cultural hegemony.